Okay, so for the next few minutes, I want you to think of yourself as a sports fan in a stadium of sorts, and this stage is the field of play, right? You're TED fans, or how many of you are TED fans? Right? How many of you have the TED app on your phone? How many of you have TED viewing parties in your office? Oh, I knew it. I knew there were people. How many of you have a TEDx Youngstown t-shirt? If you don't, see Lori, right? This makes us probably the dorkiest, nerdiest, geekiest fans ever, right? But it's what makes us cool, I think, and it's also what connects us. And if you take this setting online, where we go to interact and watch our favorite TED Talks and interact with people, like-minded people, it's really no different for sports, right? I mean, we're going there, the multitudes of fans and athletes who gather there to talk about sports. So, TEDx fans, there's a TEDx crew, they're all sitting there watching their favorite talks, and like I said, for sports, I think, this is, if you bear with me, I know it sounds a little far-fetched, but I can't help but believe in the power of sports through social media to enact some social change. And with all that's negative in the news that we hear about sports nowadays, I think it's time to turn to something a little bit more positive, right? So we'll combine these two things, sports and social media and the athletes and fans and so on who use it, and talk a little bit about how I think this is going to create some social change. Sport has the power to change the world. It has the power to inspire. It has the power to unite people in a way that little else does. Sport can awaken hope where there was previously only despair. Now, I didn't say this. Somebody else did. Anybody know who? Yeah, thank you. Nelson Mandela. You're right. You said Nelson Mandela, you're correct. He said this in 2006. He was part of a delegation that went to make the final bid for the 2010 FIFA World Cup. And many credit this speech as the reason why the cup was awarded to South Africa, right? But I think even Mandela would agree that this idea of sport having the power to change the world wasn't really that innovative. In fact, governments and politicians have been doing it for years. Look at the ancient Greeks. The ancient Greeks started the Olympics somewhere around 776 BC as a way to honor the gods and show the prowess of the young athletes, and probably for some politicians to earn some votes. But there was a cool side effect of all of this, and by bringing together all of the people of the cities of Greece, they were, in fact, creating the first sports fans. Right? These people were coming from all the cities, interacting with people that they would never otherwise meet, never otherwise see, to cheer on their favorite fans. Fast forward a few centuries later to the Roman Colosseum, sat up to 80,000 spectators. It was all about the fans. It was all about the people, bringing these people together to celebrate. Right? It was just as much as it was for the athletes and the provinces and the politicians, it was about creating this sense of social change. If you could get past all the lions killing people and stuff. That's really what it was about at the end of the day. So from the ancient Greeks to the Romans, all the way up to the modern day Olympics, different people, different purposes, different reasons, but there was always one constant, and that was the sports fan. There I am with my daughter. Where is she? Right there, our first Steelers game together. And how do we become sports fans? Well, the research is really relatively quite new. The study of sports psychology didn't gain a foothold until about the 1920s, and it wasn't until decades later that sports fandom kind of gained a foothold, because the study of sports fandom was shunned by scholars. It was treated more like a hobby than any serious kind of research. And why do we become fans? Well, we turn to the books of people like Larry Winter at Loyola Marymount University and his book entitled Media, Sports, and Society in 1989, and before him, Jeffrey Goldstein's books on sports, games, and play. They really kind of gave us the insight to who the sports fan was. It took the lens off the athlete playing on the field and put it on us in front of the TV, right, watching at home, or people like me sitting in the cheap seats in the stadium. So what do we know about the sports fan? Well, there's a lot of reasons why we become sports fans. And if you ask somebody, they'll probably give you a different answer for why they become sports fans. But we know that one of the overarching reasons is we want to feel connected. We want to be connected to people around us. Maybe when we're sitting at home watching, we're around friends and family, or we want to be connected with other people sitting with us at the stadium, or at the sports bar, or again, at home in front of the TV, or more recently, with tens of thousands of people online, millions of people online, who may be tens of thousands of miles away, who we would never otherwise interact with and never see face to face. We watch for this feeling of entertainment, for excitement, or something we like to call eustress. It's a term coined by Hans Selye. Selye was referring to this thing as a euphoric stress, or a good stress. And we heard a little bit about this from Kelly McGonigal earlier, right? And you know, you ever be in front of a TV and you're watching a game and there's an important play coming up and you just can't turn away, right? You have to watch it. Or maybe you're like me and you have to leave the room and you come back, right? You can't, that's okay. That, to some extent, is a feeling of eustress. And we like to think that for some reason we can change the outcomes of these games, right? With our, right, superstitions and ritual. Maybe you've seen the Bud Light commercials where it's only weird if it doesn't work. Yes, thank you. I remember there was a time where the Steelers were on this winning streak, and I didn't shave for a month. And let me tell you, well, you saw the picture. I mean, bald Adam Earnheardt with a beard is really not a good look. Plus, if I would have shaved and they would have lost, I would have been devastated. Why else do we watch? Well, we watch to live vicariously through our favorite teams, our favorite athletes. Robert Cialdini called this basking in the reflective glow, or berging. We berg when our favorite athletes and teams win, and when they do well, we go out and wear their jerseys the next day. We go on social media to gloat and talk smack. We watch for the beauty of sports, not because the athletes themselves are beautiful, and some of them are, but for the beauty of the game, the aesthetics. Tom Brady, quarterback of the New England Patriots, is a good-looking guy. But at the end of the day, I'm more amazed by his ability to read a pass defense than I am by his beautiful hair. Just personal. So the overall reason why we become fans, and most people will tell you this, is their connection to their first community, where they grew up. It's home. It's where they were raised. It's how they were raised. And there's me. I forget how old I was here, but I got my Steelers coat on. I'm ready to go out and cheer them on. And it's because of this that I think my story is probably similar, if you're a sports fan, to some of your stories about why you became a sports fan. I was raised in a small steel town just north of Pittsburgh, and we were encouraged to be involved with sports, to love sports. And I still remember being out on the fields as a kid trying to catch the football with my fingertips, trying to recreate Franco Harris's immaculate reception, right? Or in Little League, swinging for the fences like Willie Stargell, the Pittsburgh Pirates, and not successfully, I might add. And in elementary school, I can remember we had pep rallies, but the pep rallies weren't for our high school football teams or basketball teams. They were for the Pittsburgh Pirates and the Steelers. And it was a way to kind of connect us to the community, right? We felt the joy when they won, the sorrow when they lost, but it was all about that connection to the community. And rivals, this idea of how important rivals are to that community, to that identity for a sports fan. I can remember when the Steelers fans that would gather to protest the move of the Cleveland Browns, right? And for those of you that don't know this, the Pittsburgh-Cleveland rivalry is probably one of the most storied rivalries in all of sports. And so you might be thinking to yourself, well, then why in the world would a Pittsburgh Steelers fan protest the move of the Browns, right? Well, it was because that rivalry was as much a part of the identity for the Steelers as it was for a Browns fan. And so, in essence, losing the Browns was a hit to our identity. So we stood together. We protested side by side to try to get the owners to reconsider, to try to get the NFL to stop it. Most of you know the story. It didn't happen. The sale went forward. The move happened. But not before the NFL stepped forward and said, okay, we hear you. We hear your voices. You get to keep the name, the Cleveland Browns, the awards, the accolades, the trophies, the colors. For Pittsburgh Steelers fans, it was important because they were going to remain in the same division as us. But I can't help but think that maybe this might have had a different outcome in this age of social media, right? With the voices, all the millions of voices that fans have now on social media. Maybe, maybe not. But one thing's for sure, I know that the teams would have been listening, that the organizations would have been listening. We know that teams are out there listening to us every day on social media. They're engaging us in social media. This is just a handful of Twitter addresses of all of these teams and organizations that are out there. Why? Because they know they won't sell tickets, they won't sell TV rights, they won't sell merchandise, they won't sell hot dogs in the stadiums without us, without the sports fans. And that's why they're going here to engage us. So, how do we know that these teams are actually engaging us on social media? There's lots of evidence to suggest that they go there all the time to talk to us. The LA Kings is a good example of this. They are a little unconventional, but a little more progressive. They not only engage their own fans before, during, and after games, but then they go on to try to engage fans of other teams in a way to kind of rev up their own fans. And so they're very progressive about how they go out and use social media to interact with sports fans. Tim Crow, CEO of Synergy, said that less than 5% of TV is sport, which I find fascinating considering I have like 18 million ESPN channels, right? But that 50% of what is tweeted about is sport. Think about that. All the tweets that are sent out on a daily basis, upwards of 9,000 a minute, I think it is, something like that, that all of that is sport, and that's pretty fascinating. So it shows us that people are definitely engaged in social media about sports online. And we know that this idea of creating a global sports village through social media and sports is definitely a global phenomenon and not an American idea. I mean, just look at the followed teams and liked athletes on Facebook and Twitter. 8 of the top 10 liked teams on Facebook are European football or soccer teams, right? Number one is Barcelona. Number one's Barcelona. 52 million likes on Facebook. Their arch rival, number two, Real Madrid. I think you have to go to like Chicago Bulls and the LA Lakers to find the two American teams who are in the top 10. So that's the stats. What about the stories, right? How do we know that people are going there to be pro-social, to be positive, to talk about sports, but are they actually being pro-social? Are the fans engaging each other? Are athletes engaging fans and so on? And so I found a few stories, actually these are very recent stories too, of fans that are engaging each other online in very pro-social ways, in very positive ways. Noah Greenlee, very recently was trying to get his friend Bailey Hamilton, who suffers from a very severe form of muscular dystrophy, on SportsCenter, on ESPN SportsCenter. And so he went to Twitter to start his campaign, Get Bailey on SportsCenter. And it generated tens of thousands of retweets. And so much so that a lot of the news organizations picked up on this story and interviewed Noah and got the background story behind all of these retweets. Now, he's not on ESPN yet, but we're hoping that with all this positive momentum that may happen. And we know that the athletes are engaging their fan base online for very positive reasons. Larry Fitzgerald, wide receiver of the Arizona Cardinals, lost his mother to breast cancer in 2003. In 2012, he raised over $15,000 for breast cancer research. How? He engaged his fan base on Twitter. He gave 25 cents for every new Twitter follower, right? Someone like me, that might be $3 or $4. Someone like Larry Fitzgerald, he's going to get a lot of money. And so he's still continuing this every year. And it kind of ties in nicely with what the NFL is doing with breast cancer research. Shaquille O'Neal, former NBA standout, is still very active, probably has one of the largest Twitter followers of all athletes online. And he did this really, really cool thing this last year where he teamed up with Toys R Us and raised over $3.9 million for the Toys for Tots campaign and gathered over 325,000 toys. How? He engaged his fan base. He got those people to come online to talk about in ways that they could give, different unique ways that they could give, and the shots of him walking into the elementary schools, I didn't have any of these, but they're really cool. I mean, he's this gigantic guy, right? Much taller than me, if you can imagine. But he walks in, he's handing out toys to all these little kids. It's pretty amazing. We know that organizations globally, sports organizations, are engaging their fans to get them better connected to their athletes, right? This is a good example of an English rugby team who was getting ready to go out and compete against Australia. And so they constructed this huge St. George's cross with Twitter follower addresses, right? All the Twitter followers for the English team, this greeted them as they walked down the runway, out and down the hall, out to battle Australia. Alex Trickett, who is director of sport for Twitter UK, has some interesting blog posts about how we're using Twitter for sports now. And he had this interesting blog post back in November. He was basically saying that this is how sports organizations are connecting with athletes or connecting with fans. Welsh Rugby Union, for example, posts this contest every once in a while called Final Word, right? And it's the final word of inspiration that would greet the teams as they go out into the field of play, right? And Kayla Short posted hers. It was, if you can imagine it, you can achieve it. If you can dream it, you can become it. It's a quote from William Arthur Ward. And hers won. And so she got tickets to the game. I mean, you might not be able to see it, but her Twitter address is up there, and the athletes are seeing that, and a bunch of the athletes retweeted it. So it made her feel connected in a very pro-social way to that team. In conclusion, I think Kayla's words are really quite fitting. If you can imagine it, you can achieve it. Imagine this world where we're getting together every day to talk about sports online in very pro-social ways and using them for the side effects, right? The ways that we can raise money to bring attention to things that need to change in our society. I think it has some real possibilities. So my final, I guess, bit of words that you can kind of take forward, what you can take from this, I think there are really, really three simple things that you can do every day in social media to kind of create this global sports village, to create this world of social change. One is, let that first post that you send every day be a positive one. Let it be something optimistic. Let it be something pro-social, right? Even if it's just to say, hey, I love you to somebody, I think that's really important. Number two, talk to your children, or if you don't have children, talk to your friends' children about how they're using social media, right? Even if you have to go to social media to talk to them about how they're using social media, right? Understandable. But don't count on your elementary schools, your middle schools, or your high schools to do this, right? It's just not in the curriculum. There's no time for it. So have that conversation with them. It's really important. And finally, it's a global sports village. Be engaged with the globe, right? Be engaged with those people who are tens of thousands of miles away, right? If someone wants to friend you and they're from Africa or they're from China, friend them, right? Or like, or you know, follow them back on Twitter and have conversations with them about how you think you're using sports or whatever it is that you're into to make it a better place. Thank you.